Hello everyone, today I'm going to be helping you write your end of course strategic management or strategic planning paper. Now, this course is typically a capstone course at either the undergraduate or graduate business administration level. This is important because you're supposed to use all the information, all the things you've learned to understand a business and recommend a strategy that will help them succeed. Now, every instructor is going to have a little bit different style, what they want you to cover, how many pages your paper should be. But in general, there's two main keys you need to remember. The first thing, everything you do in strategic management should tie back to a company's mission statement and its vision. So all your recommendations should support achieving those goals. Secondly, you want to start very broad and then narrow down to a specific solution. So on the left-hand side of the screen, I have a strategy formulation flowchart. And basically, this is just showing you the steps that I would take to write a good strategic management paper. Now, one thing that I can't stress enough, you should include a company's vision and mission statement. If you don't include this as part of your paper, you are probably going to lose quite a few points because everything in strategic management ties back to the mission and vision statement. So how can you tie back to the mission and vision statement if you don't include the vision and mission statement? So let's just use Proctor and Gamble. Their mission is to provide branded products and services of superior quality and value that improve the lives of the world's consumers now and for generations to come. Okay, why is this important? One, it's important because you need to include the mission and vision statement. But we want to start broad. So with this vision and mission statement, we can start defining who is Procter & Gamble? What are they? What is their goals? Where do they want to be as an organization? And the way that I would do that is by tying this into Porter's generic strategy. So I would say, okay, based on the mission and vision statement, Procter & Gamble has aligned itself with product differentiation as opposed to cost leadership, because remember, they're wanting to provide branded products of superior quality. And they're talking about the world's consumers, so they're focusing on the broad market. So just even after the vision and mission statement, you can already start identifying some strategies for the company just by saying, okay, they're going to differentiate and they're going to focus on the broad market. And then again, after that, you want to continue focusing on the broad market, but you want to look at the competitors. You want to look at the power relationships within this market environment. And the way to do that is through Porter's five forces analysis. Now, the reason this is important is because you want to focus your strategies on the area where they're going to make the most difference. So, for example, Procter & Gamble manufactures consumer staples, things such as soap, deodorant, toothpaste, laundry detergent, right? Things that everyone uses. So, because everyone uses these, the power of the individual consumer is relatively low. On the flip side, if we were talking about a company that manufactures aircraft for the U.S. military, the consumer, since there's only one U.S. military, would have a lot of power. If you don't get that one consumer, you are going out of business, right? On the flip side of that, the bargaining power of suppliers for Procter & Gamble is relatively low, right? There's a lot of companies that make the ingredients Procter & Gamble uses to make its deodorant. So what I'm getting at is you want to see where the most powerful relationship. And in Procter & Gamble's case, it's the rivalry among firms, right? They're constantly competing for the same consumers. It's easy for me to switch from Crest to Colgate toothpaste. It's easy for me to switch from Tide to all laundry detergent, right? So Procter & Gamble's strategy should focus on addressing this producer rivalry, right? It doesn't make sense for Procter & Gamble to say, oh, we're going to institute a new strategy to crack down on the power that our suppliers have. The suppliers already don't have a lot of power. So find out where the power is in the industry and then focus your strategies on that. Now, going back to the strategy formulation flowchart, we've analyzed the generic strategy. We've analyzed the market environment. Now we want to start zooming into the company. And the way that we're going to do that is through the internal and external factor evaluation matrix. Now, this is something you should have covered in your coursework, but just to review, internal factor matrix summarizes a company's strengths and weakness regarding things that it can control. So a company, Procter & Gamble, can control its management. It can control its selling expenses, its advertising expenses, right? These are all things that it can control. So remember, when you're doing this internal matrix, an overall score of 2.5 is average. So anything less than that is below average. Anything above indicates a relatively strong internal position. The same could be said of the external matrix, except that we're looking at factors beyond the control of the company, but that still affect the company. So Procter & Gamble is affected by tariffs. It's affected by currency fluctuations. These affect the business, but it can't control them. So again, we're wanting to evaluate it on the scale of 1 to 4, with 2.5 being in the middle. The score of 2.6 says, okay, it's a little bit above average. Now, why is this important? Why do the internal and external factor evaluation matrix? The reason why is because we're establishing a baseline of where we are as a company, but we're also going to use this to create a competitive profile matrix. Now, this is where you really start to see things moving along in terms of your paper. You know a company's internal and external strengths, weaknesses, things like that. Now, you're going to be comparing it to its competitors. So you're going to identify critical success factors in your paper. You're going to say, okay, so for a consumer staples company to succeed, they need advertising, they need distribution, they need an online presence. And then what you're going to do is rate how important each of these factors are. So is strong advertising more important or less important than having good management? Is global expansion more important or less important than our online presence, right? And again, some of this as an analyst is going to be your judgment call, right? Just make sure you have a reason behind it. You're then going to rate the company based on these critical success factors, and you're going to compare it to its nearest competitors. Why is this important for your paper? Because you're going to be saying, okay, we are weak in advertising, right? Or we are strong in management. And it's not just important whether you're weak or strong, it's also important how important that factor is to success. So let's suppose that you are weak in advertising and you're weak in terms of your financial position, right? But based on the weight, you know that financial position is much more important to the success of your organization than advertising. So even though you're weak in both of them, you want to focus your improvements, your strategy, on the area where you can make the most progress. So that's what the competitive profiles matrix is helping you do. Now, this leads to the next stage of the process, which is going to be known as the matching stage. Now, the matching stage is where you're going to start suggesting strategies that are based on a company's strengths and weaknesses, its competitive position. And there's two matrices that you can start with, the grand strategies matrix and the space matrix. Now, again, I'm not going to go through how to construct all of these because this is stuff you should have covered in the course, but the strategic planning and capabilities evaluation matrix is going to give you a broad indication of whether a company should pursue an aggressive, conservative, competitive, or defensive strategy. So we're taking vision statement, mission statement. Then we're going to competitive profiles, internal strengths, weaknesses, threats, opportunities. And now we're saying, okay, given all of that, are we going to be aggressive? Do we need to focus on expansion, or do we need to kind of hold our ground, right? The second thing is the grand strategies matrix. And again, this is a general strategy, but here's the important thing. It's giving you specific options within a category. So if your company comes out and it says, we're in a market that's rapidly growing, and we're in a market that we have a strong competitive edge, we're going to be in quadrant one. Some of the things that we could do in quadrant one are market development, market penetration, product development, forward integration, related diversification. And the reason that this is important is because it's not telling you what strategy to pursue, but it's giving you ideas that would fit given your specific industry situation. So at least these are, we're starting to go from just saying, okay, you need an aggressive strategy, to, okay, what might that aggressive strategy look like? Now, once you have that, you can conduct an internal external matrix or a Boston Consulting Group matrix. And what those are doing is it's helping you identify on a segment basis where your company is the strongest. So Procter & Gamble competes in 5 broad product segments. They have beauty, grooming, healthcare, fabric and home care, and then baby, feminine, and family care. So we can say, okay, which of these segments are our most profitable? Let's suppose that it's the beauty segment, right? We can develop a strategy to enhance that beauty segment. If we have an underperforming segment, there's a different set of strategies associated with that. So within a company, you could recommend different strategies based on the segments. So what's our general strategy? Are we going to be aggressive, defensive, conservative, competitive? What would some of those strategies look like? what different divisions are going to have different strategies. Perhaps beauty, we're trying to expand, but then perhaps the home and fabric care, we're just trying to defend against competitors. We're trying to improve our socially responsible image or something like that. After that, you're going to conduct the SWOT analysis. Now, SWOT is probably one of the most important matrices that you'll use because it's developing specific strategies. And let me try to make this bigger because that's a little bit hard to see. Let me zoom in here. You're using your strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats for specific strategies. So remember when we said we're going to pursue an aggressive strategy? Now we're taking our strengths and our opportunities to create a specific actionable strategy. So if we want to use our strengths to take advantage of opportunities, we could expand e-commerce on popular emerging market websites. Now, if we were trying to defend ourselves, right, if we were occupying a defensive posture, we could say, okay, we're going to mitigate our weaknesses and threats, right? So our weakness is limited online presence. A threat is competition. We're going to mitigate these by partnering with the government to reduce fraudulent products, or we're going to expand the market retailer partnerships. And the reason that this is important, your choice of SWOT strategies. You have SO type strategies, which are strengths and opportunities. You have strengths and threats strategies. That's where you're using your strengths to overcome a threat. WO strategies, you're using an opportunity to mitigate a weakness. And then WT type strategies, where you're mitigating weaknesses and threats. The type of strategy that you pursue is going to depend on whether you're trying to be aggressive, conservative, defensive, or something like that, right? So all of these matrices build upon each other, but the SWOT matrix is where you finally decide, okay, this is a potential strategy, like this is a course of action, not in the general sense, but specifically. So let's minimize that. And then once you have two or three specific strategies, you can conduct the quantitative strategies planning matrix. Now, what this does is it uses internal factors. Gee, where did we hear about those? We learned about those all the way back at the very beginning, the internal factor evaluation matrix. We're going to use external factors, strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats. We're going to construct this matrix, and it's going to assign weights, it's going to assign ratings, and then it's going to give us a final figure on the attractiveness of each strategy. So the higher the number, the more attractive that potential strategy is. So let's zoom back in here to the strategy formulation flowchart. We've conducted the quantitative strategies planning matrix, and it says, okay, your most attractive strategy is going to be partner with local retailers or expand your online presence. So let's go back through the process, just a very brief overview to put everything back together. We want to start at the very top. What's our mission? What's our vision? Everything we do should support that. So from there, we can determine our generic strategy. Then we say, okay, where are we at as a company? What's our strengths, weaknesses, right? And then we're going to compare to our competitors to see where we need to improve, where we're doing well. After that, that's kind of like your background. That's your foundation. You say, okay, what's our general strategy going to be? Do we need to be aggressive? Are we in a rapidly growing market? Or can we be more conservative? Are we in a market where things just aren't really changing that much? Once you have that, you can develop a broad strategy. So you already have it in your mind, okay, the company needs to be aggressive. Then you can say, okay, if we were pursuing an aggressive strategy, what would that specific aggressive strategy be based on the SWOT matrix? Once you've come up with two or three strategies from the SWOT matrix, evaluate them using the QSPM. So, and then at the very end, what I would do is I would go back once I've chosen my strategy and I would say, okay, I've chosen this strategy, for example, of expanding e-commerce, and I would tie it back to my vision and mission statement and my generic strategy. So I'd say, okay, remember, our generic strategy was product differentiation based on the broad market. And I would say, okay, this expanding e-commerce strategy fits within that generic strategy because, number one, it allows us to maintain control over our brands, right? We can sell our brands direct to the consumer. They know they're getting genuine Procter and Gamble products, right? So it's allowing us to keep that differentiation, and it's focusing on the broad market, right? So go through all the process, get your strategy, and then say, okay, this is the strategy I came up with. This is why it supports the vision and the mission statement. I know that was a longer video. Strategic management is a huge course. You know, it's typically a semester-long course. I know it's a lot to cover, but hopefully the video was helpful and at least gave you a start in writing your paper. Hope you found it useful, and I'll see you next time.